Okay, so take a seat, and it's good that some of you move forward because it's easier to see the whiteboard. Let us start where we stopped. Let's look here to some summary of what we were talking about. So we are talking about perturbations in the metric, HIK, which are function of space and time, on a background which, besides kind of trivial, perhaps, dependence on position due to the fact that the special section is a sphere, but the rest of the coefficients are just functions of time. For a flat space, that's strictly the statement. We are looking at the perturbations in a distribution of matter. Energy momentum tensor, I will highlight part of the component of the energy momentum tensor, what is important. So if I take 0, 0 component being transverse, it's equal to the minus energy density with the signature that we are using. And this will remain true in linear perturbation theory as well, because if you look, you'll find out that the quantity U0 and U0 does not have linear terms in perturbations. So trace of a special part of energy momentum tensor is a pressure, P. You can check that that works out. And we have four velocity for which a special part is vanishing for the background, but is not vanishing for perturbed quantities. Now, we did talk that with respect of the three-dimensional transformation, some parts of the quantities which are in the game are scalars, 3D scalars, some 3D vectors, and some 3D tensors. And 3D scalars that we can identify here is zero components of all four-dimensional objects. So in particular, H0, 0. Also zero component of energy momentum tensor energy. I used specifically one index covariant, one contravariant. In principle, scalar is also the trace of special part, which is pressure, because trace of the metrics, you know, is invariant with respect to coordinate change. But we may want or not want to yet separate it specifically into scalar part, or maybe we can speak about all part of the special part of energy momentum tensor as a tensor. So vectors are off-diagonal metric terms, 0 alpha, and obviously three velocities, u alpha, or we had its inversion of a v alpha being equal u alpha divided by u zero. Given that for velocity space part is appearing only in a linear term, this u zero can be taken as in the background, so it's not perturbed here. And 3D tensors are part of the metric, 3D metric, H alpha beta fluctuations, and energy momentum one. Again, I can go and look inside the metric and find its trace, and it will be a scalar, but in a way, I don't want to do it. You'll see why. Okay, so what else we discussed? We discussed that those quantities can be expanded in eigenfunctions of the Laplacian, special Laplacian on a hypersurface of a constant time, background hypersurface of a constant time, which is a constant curvature, one of the constant curvature spaces. And we talk about one particular eigenfunctions, type of eigenfunctions. So I'll write it as a Q, and I'll write the Laplacian as two covariant, three-dimensional covariant derivatives, being equal minus E square Q. So that's actually a general form for eigenfunctions of the Laplacian, either for a flat space or not for a flat space or of different types. But the one which we looked specifically of in a flat space was a plane wave, e to the ak alpha x alpha. And for now, I will be speaking only about flat space. And I will be speaking about metric perturbation as my main object, first of all. And then I will just reiterate what's happened with energy momentum tensor without kind of more derivations. So I will be looking at H0, 0, H0 alpha, and H alpha beta. So that's a good example. Now, this solution of the Laplace equation is very particular one, that it is a scalar function. And I'm following the notation of a Bardeen. I will add for this I will add index 0 for this particular solution. Now, the fact that this solution is a scalar function does not mean that you cannot build vectors and tensors out of it. And this is what we need to do in order to describe vectors and tensors, fluctuating vectors and tensors. So, scalars can be expanded directly in this function. So, H0, 0 as a function of x and t is, I don't know, sum. And now I will start using, again, Bardeen's notation. So I will write it as an amplitude, which is in principle a function of k and time, and q zero for a particular k and x, right, which is a plane wave. Tau, yes, eta. Right, or tau, eta. Bardeen used tau, so I use eta. Now, I will simplify my notation in a sense that I will not consider, right, so the reason why this expansion in the Fourier harmonics is useful and formulation was we had another twist on it in the discussion after the first lecture. You can take any function of a special coordinate and expand it into the eigenfunction of Laplacian, because eigenfunction of Laplacian, the remission operator, gives you a complete orthonormal set of basis functions. So you can expand it to that. Why is it useful for a perturbation theory? Is that all coefficients in a perturbation equations are functions of time only. And so if you do this expansion, in flat space, just in Fourier harmonics, then every amplitude at every eigenvalue will evolve independently of the other one. There's no coupling between the modes. And correspondingly, we will simplify our notation in a way that we will drop this index k everywhere, and I will write my perturbations H0, 0 as being equal just simply a of eta, q0 of x, meaning that I took one particular wave, and I'm looking what is happening with the perturbation of that particular wave. And correspondingly, all other quantities will be expanded in because the same wave will be taken for them. Okay, so now I need to, so I know what how I describe my scalar, and this is introduces one of the perturbation functions for which Einstein equation will give you equation. And it will be ordinary differential equation, which involves time derivative, and all special derivatives in expansion will acquire some k factors in front, and that's it, and will be algebraic. Now, I need vectors, and I need tensors. So for the vectors, I will, the one way to do it is to introduce a vector which is essentially a derivative, and that's the only way to do it, is a derivative of my plane wave. I'll put covariant derivative alpha. And in reality, if it is actually flat space, and I will be, again, of the flat space, this is just Cartesian scalar product. There's nothing particularly interesting covariantly which is happening. It will be just I k alpha u zero. Oh, no, I'm not writing plane wave. E to the I k alpha x alpha. So in reality, Bardeen does a little bit different definition for this function. So just have it. It's actually defined as minus 1 over k and covariant derivative. So this is redefinition. So it will have a minus sign, and it will be divided by the magnitude k. So let me put it here. So that's my definition. Well, I guess it is done so that coefficient in front is dimensionless. Just tells you about direction of the vector. But I'm actually using, when I write my formula, so you usually don't have this k factor typically, so it's, right. So being derivative, this means that in configuration space, any vector is actually a gradient of some function. So now you start to see that, you know, to define such a vector field, you need to specify one more scalar function from which you then take a derivative. So it's still kind of scalar degree of freedom in a sense that that's what needs to be defined. So my h0 alpha in this case, and I'll again follow the notation, will be equal, so there's a little bit of definition of a coefficient, minus a square b, I'll actually put 0 here, also b0. This is function of eta and u alpha 0. Let me a little bit make myself nicer, and I'll put it on the same level as h0, 0, so that they all come together. So now we need to work with tensor quantities. And so how many tensors can I make out of a plane wave? And here it so happens that I have a choice. I actually can do it in more than one way, and namely in the two ways. First of all, I can take a plane wave and I can just multiply it by a metric, g alpha beta. And this will be my tensor, and I'm very happy with that. But on the other hand, I can do other things. I can take my plane wave, and I can differentiate it twice. Well, I write in general covariant derivative. So in this case, it will be, this is obviously what it is. Here it will be minus k alpha k beta e to the I k gamma x gamma here. If it is a plane wave. Again, in terms of q, it is all valid for curved special sections as well. In terms of plane waves, it's specific to a flat space. So I can essentially make two kind of my overall expansion of a metric will have two possible quantities, and therefore it requires two amplitudes. So, except what I will notice that I will maybe want a little bit to redefine my tensors, given that this guy has a trace, it actually describes effectively diagonal terms. Well, not diagonal, but proportional to the metric. But if you take a trace, it is a trace of the tensor, C alpha alpha or H alpha alpha. So this guy also has a little bit of a trace. So instead, I will introduce traceless version of it. Q0 alpha beta. So that's it will be defined as 1 over k square Q0 derivatives and plus 1/3. To some extent, I can probably for notation, I can use here my gamma, which is without scale factor A. I'm not so gamma alpha beta, probably. I don't know. Gamma alpha beta and Q zero. Now, in terms of the plane waves, this little guy has form 1/3 delta alpha beta minus K alpha, K beta, K beta. If I raise an index, so it will be Kronecker symbol over K square, U, plane wave, e to the I, K gamma, X gamma. So that's with a mixed indices alpha beta, this function will look like that. So now my tensor H alpha beta in its expansion will have two terms to be defined, and we'll define it in a way that it is H A square. In front, and here is 2HL of eta multiplied by gamma alpha beta Q0. So this is the first type of tensor. And second will be another one, and 2HT of eta multiplied by Q0 alpha beta. My bracket should be square. So out of a plane wave scalar solution of a Laplace equation, I can describe my perturbations, particular perturbations in a metric tensor, and actually similarly in other tensors of a rank two in a similar way with the help of four functions. A, B for every given mode, HL, NHT. Coefficients like 2 is just a convenient definitions for kind of customary definitions. So the whole metric fluctuation has 10 components, and they are described by four functions. So perturbations in those components are described by four functions. So the question is, overall, is this do those four functions can describe all possible fluctuations of those 10 components in the metric? or maybe they don't describe every possible way to perturb. And we do know that they cannot describe all possible perturbations with our example of the vector, right? So we had a vector and we talked about that what this type of perturbation describes is a potential perturbations, where a vector is a gradient of some potential functions. Obviously, not every vectors are potentials of the, of some function. Potentials are gradients of some function, right? You know, there is a rotational vectors which have curl but don't have divergence, right? So therefore, not all possible way to perturb my quantities are being accounted for. Something is still missing. And so what is missing, or not what is missing, well, what is missing is that plane wave, scalar plane wave, is not the only possible type of solution for Laplace eigenvalue problem. So there are other solutions which are not reduced to scalar plane wave. So other solutions for Laplacian eigenvalues, eigenvalue problem, right? Or eigenfunctions problem. All right, so we need a solution that cannot be reduced back to what we already have. So we need to something special. And well, there is nothing new to be done with the scalar quantities. It is what it is. But it is starting with the vectors that we're missing something. So we want to describe a curl type of contribution for the vector field. So what kind of a wave is a curl but not divergence in Fourier representation? Maybe you know that. Not everybody knows right away. So how to write Fourier mode for the vector which is curl, which is a rotational vector, right? So tell me. Huh? Yeah, but I am speaking. Okay, so here is was an example how I will write something which is a gradient of some function, right? So that's a Fourier representation. You as I discussed, it is a longitudinal vector in Fourier mode, or a Fourier mode aligned with the direction of a mode propagation or mode fluctuation. So what kind of representation is not leading to the, it is a transverse vectors. All right, so we need a solution for eigenvalue, which is transverse. So we need, again, solution of some quantity Q alpha, and I will write index one for it to distinguish it from zeros. So which is half Laplace equation, beta, equal minus k square q1 alpha, which is transverse. So transverse means it cannot be, in a configuration space, it means it cannot be reduced to the gradient of some function. So how it looks in a Fourier space? In Fourier space, such function must look like some vector, what letter did I use? So that S alpha, e to the I k alpha x alpha, but S should point orthogonally to the propagation direction. So S alpha must be under condition that it is orthogonal to the vector field. What does it mean? It means that if I will take a divergence of this vector field, so Q alpha slash alpha, that will be reduced to some I K alpha S alpha plane wave, and that will vanish. So I'm looking for a vector type solution for Laplace eigenvalue problem such that the vectors Q alpha 1 is divergence free. So that's a condition that I need to satisfy. And again, for the plane wave, we explicitly know how this solution looks like. For the flat space and plane waves, we know how this solution looks like. So I cannot use this guy to perturb. So if I make that perturbations where I make, you know, vortices of velocity, for example, then vortices of velocity do not perturb energy density. So energy density, say, remains uniform. So scalars, 3D scalars, cannot be perturbed with such modes, with such motions. So H0 alpha will not be perturbed, but H00 will not be perturbed, but H0 alpha will be described by the new functions, and, well, we'll call it B1, Q alpha. And I'm starting to skip in on arguments just to shorten my notes. So now we come to the question, can we make tensors out of this, three tensors out of this mode as well? Well, and we can do that because we can again differentiate. So the only way essentially to do it is to differentiate it. So for tensors, we have Q alpha beta 1, which will be obtained. And in a second, I may correct for the coefficients by Q alpha 1, and it is differentiated with respect to beta. We'll do a little bit different. We'll symmetrize it. We'll take symmetrical part of it. And we'll divide it by minus 1 over k here. So this will describe perturbation in a tensor parts, which are symmetrical, but which comes from a kind of vertical type of vector perturbations. So you may ask, can I make anti-symmetric tensor out of that? And the answer is yes, I can. I can make put a minus sign. It will be another tensor which is anti-symmetric in its indices. Well, the only question is I don't need it. For example, my metric perturbation is symmetric by definition. Well, if I need it for something else, I may come back and introduce new quantity. But on a first level, I don't encounter in my theory. So what is the property of this guy? So I can take divergence of this guy, Q alpha beta comma beta c 1. And I find out that it is not equal to 0, so it has a divergence because it is, So the first term Q alpha beta beta, so it will be minus 1 over k and minus k square Q 1 alpha. So if I make divergence of the first term, and if I make divergence of a second term, that will actually vanish. Because second term will look like this condition, differentiated. But importantly, it is not equal to zero. However, if I differentiate once more, U1 alpha beta comma, take one more divergence alpha on both indices, then this is derivative of that with respect to alpha, and it is vanishing. So that actually is zero. So my tensor, H alpha beta, for example, can be expanded in those functions, and it has a shape of H square, 2HT1 Q alpha beta 1 type of mode. Again, I use the same HT here as it is, well, HT here, let me put zero here. And because those are coefficients in front of the tensor form, which are traceless. This guy is traceless, and this guy is traceless. Yeah, if I just simply take a trace out of it, it vanishes. Okay, and again, H00 is unperturbed for that. So at this stage, I may ask myself, am I done completely? And the answer is no, I'm not yet done completely, because I completely describe my vectors. There's potential component and rotational component. That's it. There is nothing else. But I have not yet described my rank two tensors completely. I selected something which is built from the gradients and, well, second derivatives of the scalars. I get something which built from a first derivative of the vectors, but there is something which cannot be reduced to either of two. And so we have the third type of solutions that are important, and I will write it as a Laplace equation gamma gamma function 2 equal minus k square q alpha beta 2. And so I need to have several conditions for q so that it is not reduced to the previous thing. So first of all, it should have a zero trace. Because if it has a trace, it's just a scalar function. But second thing, that it is something which have to have a zero divergence. So same thing as I had with my vector, that on a scalar front, vectors was described with something which has divergence, and things which were not reduced to that is divergence-free part of vector field. And so here for the tensors, I had something which has a divergence, non-vanishing, and now I need a divergence-free part. So I need a condition Q alpha beta slash beta equal to zero. Or maybe let me put it, nice covariant derivative of on top, whatever's in that. So how it can look like in terms of the plane wave? Well, it should be given by some tensor at every k harmonic, alpha, beta, e to the I k alpha x alpha. But this guy has to have conditions which would force conditions that I need. So it needs to have a zero trace. And if I now take a divergence out of this expression, I will have E alpha beta K beta appearing after I do differentiation and contract on an indices, and that has to vanish. Then I am free divergence. So in principle, I could ask myself, do I need to have a symmetric version? And again, it was the same argument as here. Usually you don't need anti-symmetric one, so we'll stick with a symmetric version, in which case it automatically follows that I can contract on another equal to zero, well, and E alpha beta equal E beta alpha. So I guess if you have anti-symmetric part, then these two conditions are separate, but for symmetric part, one is enough. I cannot make any vector out of it because I need to get rid of some beta index. So I have K in my game. I can multiply by Ks in order to get rid of a vector, of an index, but all of this vanishes due to vanishing divergence. So that's kind of two. So therefore, I do have my H alpha beta, one more chance for perturbation, and it has the same form as before, Q alpha beta 2, but does not have any other kind of additional contributions. So in total, so in principle, if I have higher order tensors in my theory, I could go on and continue defining other irreducible kind of tensors, which cannot be reduced to the lower rank ones by requiring absence of more and more divergences. But again, I don't need it. If you tell me I need it, I'll do it, right? So in general, therefore, we have seven functions here. One, two, three, and four for one part. One and two for another part. And the last one is here. Now, what is in the red is called vector scalar type of perturbations. And it does not mean that you perturbed only scalars. You perturb scalars and tensors, but all your perturbations are built from a scalar functions by differentiation, all your tensors of higher rank. Those two things are called vector perturbations. It is proper to think irreducible vector perturbations. So it is something which you build from modes which cannot be reduced to the scalar functions. It's essentially vectorial. And that perturbs vectors and tensors. And the last one is a tensor perturbations. Again, irreducible tensor perturbations, which you cannot make any vector, scalars and vectors out of it, so they perturbed only tensor part of your matrices. So this is a basic classification of a perturbations into scale, vector, and tensor modes. And why is it important? Is that when you, the most general perturbations is a mix of all the modes. But if you put this mix in the equation which relates quantities, then you can project out mode by mode so that each of them has to satisfy the equations independently on each other. So let me try to, in my usual not very brilliant way of writing equations, write it down. So I'll use this part of a board, but then I will maybe erase it and I will decide how I should go further on. So let me have something from H alpha beta, right, which is perturbed in the most general ways. So it contains it contains, for example, HL Q alpha beta 0 plus HT1 Q alpha beta 1 plus HT2 Q alpha beta 2 plus HL gamma alpha beta Q 0. So that's kind of the most general fluctuations that you put in your metric, which has all kind of modes, right? And then you have equation where all this acting with some operator is equal to something which is in the same way, which is also has all possible modes. Then you can come to that and differentiate and take divergence of this equation. And if you take one divergence of this equation, then tensor mode will drop out. So it is only this part has to be equated to corresponding part here. You take one more divergence, both tensor part and vector part will drop out. So scalar terms has to balance each other. So they establish their own independent equation. You subtract it from the original equation, that means that the rest has to balance itself. Take one divergence, you're left only with vector mode equal vector mode, they have to balance on each other. And subtract back, tensor mode has to balance on each other. So those modes, by their algebraical structure, do not talk to each other, they are independent. And correspondingly, you perturbed one and it remains of this type through the whole evolution. It does not start feeding into another modes, etc. All right, so let us now see what do we have on a matter side. So matter side is also a tensor. And it has corresponding similar things, but with the only difference that for the matter side, we kind of also use this energy and pressure. But I can write just that I have delta T, and I'll write it for the mixed component 0, 0. And it will be equal to the minus background energy density, and I will call it delta. Delta is a perturbations in energy density for us. And it is Q zero of X, right? So that's a scalar piece. It's perturbed with the same harmonic as H0, 0. It has a different amplitude. So that's a new functions to be used up. So with the same type of thing, I can do anisotropic part Oh, not an isotropic special part, T alpha beta. But for T alpha beta, I have fluctuation, right? So I have just simply different notation for the part which is proportional to the trace, and we call it pressure, right? So we have pressure, background pressure, pi of L, zero delta alpha beta. And then we have a traceless part, so it is essentially a stress or strain part of an energy momentum tensor, not what is on the diagonal. And that has P0 pi T 0 U alpha beta. Yeah, notice if I take divergence of this, then this, oh, that's Q0 is here. Q0. Then this thing will be made into just scalar functions. So it, and so on. So for vector piece which appears in our description is our three velocities. So we'll expand our three velocities. This time I put index up. And so it is V, we'll leave the letter V for that eta and U alpha of X. So for this hydrodynamical energy momentum tensor, we have in particular three, well, also four, the three is four scalar components, scalar amplitudes in general to describe its perturbation. And kind of so on for vector and tensor mode. This will perturb to my three velocity and traceless part of the strain tensor, and this will perturb just in a particular way a strain tensor if it is possible. Now, when you describe a matter, it is actually, as I said, energy momentum tensor is not a complete description of the matter in general. So you need to add extra physical insight to talk about what kind of perturbations matter supports. Well, the fact that energy momentum tensor is not necessarily a complete description is already for a tensor in this form. In order to have a closed set of equation of motions, you need to know how pressure is related to energy density. So this is usually called equation of state. An equation of state has to be provided from independent physical consideration. So it is not anywhere in this formula. So therefore, for example, when we deal with the tensor perturbations, so for energy momentum tensor, you can have T alpha beta, you can have to be exactly in my notation, this P0. What did I put in the notation? Let me check. I will put it as P0 pi T2 U alpha beta 2. Nevertheless, it is an independent question whether your matter is actually supports anisotropic stresses, right? So if it is really ideal fluid with Archimedes' law, it supports only isotropic pressure. It does not support anisotropic stresses. So you cannot perturb it. So this perturbation cannot be, well, will not exist, right? But So what kind of metric perturbation is? What part of physics described by which modes? So if you look at the scalar modes, this is the only mode which supports perturbation of energy density of matter. So correspondingly, if you are interested in developing of the structure of the universe, something where density distribution changes and not uniform, you know, scalar modes are responsible for the linear part of that instabilities. Right? So you cannot induce energy density fluctuations if you just make rotational motions of your matter in linear sphere. So this part supports, which is not written down, rotational motions, as I said. But this part supports transverse traceless fluctuations of a special metric, and that is nothing else but gravitational waves in linear theory. So irreducibly tensor part of fluctuations of the metric are gravitational waves. And as you see with our energy momentum tensor, they essentially do not interact with energy momentum tensor. So there is a dense, if there is a gravitational wave perturbation in a isotropic and homogeneous universe, then the matter is unperturbed, it's uniform in density, and it does not move. It has zero velocities. The only thing which it may have and be coupled is if matter supports this corresponding transverse off-diagonal stresses. And that's not what ideal fluid supports. And so in this sense, in a linear theory, gravitational waves will be freely propagating without usual interaction with the matter at a linear level. All right? Okay, so that is one part of my goal, to describe this classification in the three type of modes. Scalar, vector, and tensor. Notice that it is shifted in the meaning from what is scalar, vector, and tensor parts of a metric. So you can build all pieces out of scalars and less pieces out of reducible vectors and less pieces out of tensors as well. Now the question is, perhaps, what is happening if now I'm not having the plane waves for which I could write easily explicit modes? So flat space and plane waves. What if my special sections are curved? Well, either surface of a three sphere or surface of a three hyperbolic. And short answer is that nothing changes. You still are looking for eigenfunctions of a three types, but your Laplace operator is modified because it is defined on a curved space, so there are extra terms and solutions are not explicitly plane waves, but some more complicated function. Say on the surface of a sphere, it is something like 3D spherical harmonics, not 2D spherical harmonics, which you know and love, but kind of 3D spherical harmonics, which has some parts, ordinary one, and some radial dependence in some representation. Now, you know, people who are from IUCA, they can ask Tarun Saurabh, and they will give you a code which generates eigenfunctions of Laplacian for a sphere. Well, that's the one which I use. And from the point of view of theory, so this was built for cosmology for curved spaces also in mid-60s. There was Lifshitz with Halatnikov paper in 67, but it's already summary paper. And I think Harrison around 67 developed mathematics for eigenfunction, and not only eigenfunction, but separation into scalars, vector, and tensor parts for the spheres, for curved spaces. What is important about the curved spaces, the only thing, is that in a flat space, if it is, how to say, unbounded, you have a continuous spectrum of eigenvalues. K square can take any possible values. And it is, well, it is always positive, and it is a plane wave. But the spectrum of eigenvalues for the curved spaces is somewhat different. In particular, sphere is a finite volume space, and therefore spectrum of the eigenvalues of the Laplacian is discrete. So not every wave numbers are possible, and structure of the eigenvalues for the sphere looks something, I don't know where to, I'll take this part of the this piece of space, is on a sphere is Q, alpha alpha is equal something like minus n square minus one Q, right? So it is discrete and does not allow for zero value of n. So it starts from n equal to one. And so this is eigenvalue structure on the surface of a sphere of unit radius. So it's essentially wave numbers are measured in the units of curvature value, one over r, but r is the unity, so it's unity. And this is dimensionless, so that's how it works. So it's in unit of curvature radius. So that's on a sphere. And on a hyperboloid, it has a structure of minus n square plus one u, but for hyperboloid, this n is actually a fake n. It can be a non-integer because hyperboloid is infinite. But the only thing is that although we are looking at a positive eigenvalues, it is actually a question on a hyperboloid, can we allow n square to be negative, like minus one, or minus 0.5. So what happens with those mods? And so these are so-called supercurvature mods on a hyperboloid, and they are not normalizable. So they're in principle not to be, no need to be included into full set of basis functions. So they actually do not, well, integral over square of them, even in generalized way, cannot be made finite. So it's they're actually exponential growing one. And the very last comment about this mod structure is that we talked about a special cross section to have constant curvature, which is a local condition. One interesting direction of the research, kind of side direction of research, is to study cosmological model which have spaces which are topologically compact special sections. Like, for example, if you are living on a surface of a flat torus rather than infinite plane, that, of course, immediately introduces for you discreteness of the eigenvalues of the Laplacian. So you get some selection rule. Not all possible plane waves are allowed. Some of them are kind of don't fit periodic boundary conditions, etc. Right? But again, that does not modify the basis theory, which we need to talk about today. So I guess I'll stop here today because now I will need to talk about gauges, and this is all new topic. So I better start new lectures from fresh start. fresh topic tomorrow. All right, see you tomorrow. Unless you want to ask me questions, which you are welcome to do so.